Good evening. I'll never forget the incredible, effective denunciation of John Turner by Brian Mulroney during that famous debate when, talking about patronage, Mulroney told Turner he had an option. And he, Mulroney, was going to wipe out this dreadful patronage system in Canadian politics. Has he? We'll talk about that tonight. But first, here's Ted with the rundown.
The Anglican Church in South Africa says it will resort to violence if that's what it takes to end apartheid. So will it be a peaceful solution or a bloody war? Webster takes up the issue with Archbishop Ted Scott, former primate of the Anglican Church and an opponent of racism. But first, should new Canadian citizens be coached on how to vote? Taxpayers say no, so citizenship judges in Canada are facing a review because of complaints. In the studio with Webster, David Crombie, Secretary of State and Multiculturalism Minister.
Mr. Crombie, I understand you're in command of the patronage appointment for Citizenship Court judges.
Well, Citizenship Court judges are appointed by what's known as Order in Council, which is the Cabinet.
And of course, you must be a Tory to be appointed to the Citizenship Court. Is that not correct?
That's not correct.
Are there any non-Tories been appointed by you?
I haven't appointed any.
But 35 have been appointed by the Conservative government.
There are 35 Citizenship Court judges across the country, and some of those have been appointed by the current government, some are appointed by the previous government.
Mr. Crombie, let's forget the double talk. Okay. You are now replacing all the retiring Liberal appointees with Conservatives.
That, I'm not doing that, but if you're suggesting that in the past the way in which Citizenship Court judges have been appointed and that there was a strong association with party allegiance, the answer to that has been, generally speaking, true, no matter who is in government.
As a matter of fact, you're going to have an inquiry into a review of the competence and performance of the citizenship judges by the chief judge, who is a Tory crony.
Well, two things. One, there's a review. There are two things to remember. One is a complaint about a specific judge.
What was that complaint?
Well, no, there's a complaint about a specific judge. In fact, there are a series of complaints about the same judge in terms of attitude within the
court. Was that the one who said they consider voting for the Conservative Party?
No, he resigned.
Oh, he resigned.
Yes.
I see.
This is a complaint which the chief judge is investigating. There is also a review of the whole system, which should have been done some time ago, and I am now conducting that review. And that review, I hope, will be done by March, April.
You've double-talked me a little bit. There is no way a Liberal is going to be appointed a Citizenship Court judge. Am I correct?
I have no idea whether that is true or not true, Jack, because we're not in the business at this point of appointing any. I have frozen all appointments until the review is completed.
What does the job pay?
$49,500, I think, is the actual
amount. How long is the training?
The specific training is a week, I think.
Yes. Right. Great job. How long is the appointment?
The appointment's for 2 years.
2 years, and you just sit there and swear people an oath?
Well, I think there's two things. One, there are many of the Citizenship Court judges, I might say, mm-hmm. are really first-class people. And I know that you and I can talk our way about the importance of changing a system which has been related to patronage, and that with that I agree, which is why I'm carrying out the review. But let's not diminish the importance of the work they do, and indeed, the job that's really well done by all the Citizenship Court judges. Court judges, except from time to time, there are complaints. For example, yesterday, Jack, I am in Edmonton, and I am at the Friendship Center. A judge is swearing in 20 citizens from 17 countries, and we use the sweetgrass ceremony as part of the ceremony. I'll tell you.
Can we afford it?
In the Friendship Center, the Friendship Center is a relatively cheap place to hold it. And I can tell you.
Let me go to your Achilles heel, though.
I just want you to make sure that We deal with the question of patronage, which I'm going to do through the review, but let's not diminish the importance of citizenship and the importance of Citizenship Court judges to that process.
Cut Georges.
I'm sorry.
There was one Cut George, Stephen Walter, a well-known advocate of the Conservative Party, resigned last month when citizenship applications revealed he had made derogatory remarks about the opposition parties and urged applicants to consider supporting the Tories. That is intolerable, isn't it?
Of course it is. And when the complaint was raised, I indicated I would report back to the House in 3 days, in which case I reported back to the two that he had resigned.
Are you, in your review, going to recommend that political cronyism not be a qualification?
Yes.
Will you get away with it?
You're going to have to think of another topic, because the answer is yes. So I'm not interested in perpetuating political cronyism. I'm interested
yes,
in making
are.
Sure. No, I'm not. I'm interested in making
Your
sure
made that
we've
all
got
kinds
the
of
best
political...
citizenship court judges the country can offer. As a
well,
matter of fact,
you could get distinguished citizens.
When you retire from here, you're eligible.
No, distinguished citizens could serve on that on a voluntary basis and save the taxpayer a hell of a lot of money.
Not a bad idea. And in fact, that's an idea which has been suggested to me, and I passed on to the people who will be doing the reviewing. Not only that, not only just volunteer, but why wouldn't we also appoint on a part-time basis those people with standing in the community, which would allow them once or twice a month to participate in the ceremony for citizenship.
Are you going to do all you can to wipe out the blatant political patronage and the appointments both by the Liberals and yourself to citizenship courts?
Yes. The Prime Minister said to me, and said publicly, it looks like the system's a bit of a boondoggle, will you fix it up? And I said, aye, aye, sir.
Well, that'll be a change for
True.
Brian, too, I don't mind telling you,
oh,
on
no.
patronage. Now, tell me the apology you made to that fine organization called Real Women. And viewers should remember that when they applied for money, you ignored them as Real Women. But when they put in a phony application for the National Association of Lesbian Mothers or something, they got instant cooperation with your department. Now, why did you apologize to them?
First of all, when the Real Women put in an application 18 months ago, there was not a process which was available to them, which was direct and open and efficient. And I apologized to them because I said to them they should have that right as citizens or as groups of citizens. Secondly, though, the question about their second application to the lesbian mothers and all of that, I don't have that as a matter of public record. I've heard people repeat it. I don't know that to be true. But in any case, Real Women put in an application 18 months ago. They should have been dealt with more appropriately, and I apologize because they had not.
But they won't get any money.
They will if they have a project that they want to make an application for, and it's within the terms and conditions of the women's program, which has been in place for 15
years.
But
theirs is a square, non-liberated application just to help defend and build up family life, and you won't give money for that.
Well, I'm not sure what they might want to do a project on, but the women's program, of course, deals with a whole variety of subjects. We have 571 groups who were funded last year, and over 15 years, there have been hundreds and hundreds of groups on many, many topics. For example, dealing with women in the workplace, women at home, equal pay, issues of concern to pensions, all of those things. Now, those are topics clearly within the program, women's program, and if I have an application for a project within that, then I indicated to them in the letter, an excellent letter, by the way, indicated in that letter that they would be dealt with clearly, openly, justly, and fairly.
Okay, Japanese. Have you been meeting with the Japanese Canadian Association in Vancouver?
Yes, I have. I met today.
Are they still after big money?
They have the same proposal.
Because of the obvious injustices delivered to them after the war.
They have the same proposal that they had in May of this year, and it has about 8 different items.
How much they want?
It's changed a bit, but they want X. I shouldn't use figures because I think that they may want to put their own case forward. But they want X amount for individual compensation. They want Y amount for the commemoration.
I remember Trudeau saying he's prepared to apologize and regret the behavior. And then there was a proposition of $10 million for a foundation, especially, I suppose, for education and whatnot.
Yeah.
Are you going to go for something big like a couple of $100 million?
Well, all of those matters, let me deal with what I have done. When I was asked to take it over by the Prime Minister, I indicated that what I wanted to do was deal with it in my own way. And that was to, first of all, have some discussion about the process by which we would have some understanding of all of the groups and all of the individuals who might have something to say about the government before I make my recommendations to the Cabinet. I intend to make my recommendations for process and elements of a just settlement to the Cabinet, hopefully in February. I will have completed my consultation process by that time. And therefore...
Then you'll tell us
then,
what you recommend.
Then I'll engage in a public discussion with respect to the process and the elements for a just settlement.
More chats with David Crombie, Minister of State. What's your full title?
Secretary of State and... Minister responsible for multiculturalism.
Can I have a set of bagpipes, please?
Listen, you are my first call.
And your calls, too, after the break. I was always a great one for homogenization, Mr. Crombie. I've never made any bones about the fact that we seem to pour an awful lot of money down the drain in multiculturalism when people should be coming Canadians and pay for their own multiculturalism if they want a set of bagpipes.
Well,
how much do we spend on multiculturalism?
$17 million a year in the multiculturalism department.
That's for all the various folk
dancing
groups? That's for everything.
That's for everything.
Toronto Scottish Society get any money?
More than their share.
They shouldn't get it. And a Scotch group here got money from the social credit government, which offended me.
Yeah?
All these wealthy doctors pay their own.
No, I think to the extent that people can and do it themselves, they should. I agree with that.
Next thing. How do you feel with the polls at 28%? Doesn't it bring back grim reminders of the Diefenbaker deaths?
Well, I know most people make the analogy, but I think that there's a strong difference. And one of those key important differences is, if you cast your mind back, is that Mr. Diefenbaker was plagued by a divided cabinet and a divided caucus. And that is not the case in 1986. In 1986, Prime Minister Brian Mulroney leads a united caucus and a united cabinet.
Have you found a conservative on the street since you came to Vancouver today? Unless you bumped into Pat Carney, maybe.
I didn't bump into Pat Carney because I know she's busy. And I'm sure that there were lots of people who were Tories that passed me by.
There's a considerable resentment building up here now.
Sure.
And it's purely economic. 4.2% unemployment in Toronto. Peterson screaming, calling an election if they touch the auto pact. Peterson fighting against our 15% deal in the tariffs, you know. And it would seem that Hogtown is getting bigger, happier, and wealthier, and we are pleading, please, for contracts for icebreakers. We're in a bad state in BC. Do you people realize that in the East?
Yes, we do, Jack. I have no question about it. I might say when we came back, the government came back after the Christmas break in the first meeting. The most important discussion has been about the fact that the economic development and the economic recovery in some ways has been so uneven. And it's not just, I might say, an east-west problem, because southern central Canada, has recovered exceedingly well. But in Atlantic Canada, and indeed the northern part of Quebec and the northern part of Ontario in the west, is where it's been nowhere near. And, that's a difficulty.
Economists are talking here about the Newfoundlanding of British Columbia.
That's why I might say that the government spends, I know that people say, oh, what are they doing back there? But the fact of the matter is that there's an enormous amount of time spent and expertise to try and draw on, to see what we do to make sure that the growth is more evenly distributed.
But mind you, you're free enterprises, and it's a question of live or die, survival. It's your political philosophy.
And it's a conflict that's got to be dealt with, because what the market says is one thing, and what government policy in order to redress the balance is required to do is another. And therefore, you have to try and join the two to support the market.
Go ahead to David Crombie.
Mr. Crombie, I would like to commend you, sir, on the stand that you have taken with regard to the not giving any money to the real women. I do not feel that they represent the majority of women in Canada, and I commend you on your stand, sir.
Well, thank you very much. I'm not one to normally give up a commendation, but let me say to you, I treated the application...
Because you might lose a real woman vote.
I treated the application solely as a question of an application for funds and treated it like any other. No other body, no other group has received money for operational funding in the first time. We've always required that there be a track record of project funding. It was on that basis that I made the decision.
Go ahead, please.
Yes. I would like to discuss your first topic on patronage, sir. It seems to me, if I remember quite correctly, that Mr. Mulroney, at some time prior to the election, did state on CBC that he was going to replace everyone with a conservative. Now, he made that clear to people. Also, I've heard the argument over and over again in the last 2 years with this patronage. I've heard the argument that liberals did it. Well, I'd like to remind you that you people were elected because you said you wouldn't do it. Now, 2 years later, you're saying this, you're using the same argument, and I would like to ask you one question. I would like to ask you to make a commitment to the people here of BC that after these 35 posts are the people are chosen for that, if it seems very obvious that political patronage has played a major role, either in decisions prior to electing these people, that the Conservatives don't say amongst themselves, all right, to make it look good, will have at least 15% of the people, liberal or whatever, to choose the man who fits the job.
Okay, he's a bit complicated, but he wants a pledge, no more patronage, and you can't give that pledge.
You've already asked me whether or not we're going to review the system with you to making sure that it was nonpartisan, and I indicated that I was. I might say to my friend who just called that it was the Prime Minister who said publicly that he thought the system had been a bit of a boondoggle and asked me if I would undertake the review, which is something that has not been done in the past. Mm-hmm. I would also say that there have been some very impressive appointments made to Citizenship Court judges. Right here in the city, for example, Angela Khan, the first Chinese-Canadian to be appointed as a Citizenship Court judge. And I would think that most people would find that her political, are impeccable.
Oh, yeah. I'm glad you got that in. That was a good
appointment. I want to get that in.
That was Carney's appointment. That's fine. That's a good appointment. But, I mean, you mustn't sit there, Mr. Crombie, with all deference, respect, and humility, and pretend that political patronage is anything other than blatant in many appointments.
I didn't pretend that. That's why, in fact, I used the Prime Minister's word. He said it was a boondoggle.
He was asked me to
correct it, which is what I'm doing.
You're telling me that Maroney said, Davy boy, the appointment of judges to the citizenship courts has become a boondoggle.
Well,
Clean it up.
He said that publicly.
But that's what you have to do.
Yes.
Well, of course, he's very good, you know, appointing the odd NDPer to take the cuss off and the odd Liberal to take the cuss, like Stephen Lewis, you know. Like, who else was it? The guy who went to, the speaker that went to...
Well, the new ambassador to Ireland.
Yeah, oh yes. McDermott from the CLC.
Of course.
Well, that's just a token appointment to take the cuss off all the Tories, isn't it?
Is it working?
Not with me. Go ahead, please.
Yes. Good afternoon, gentlemen. Just 2 points. Every week you seem to see a new claim by some native band somewhere in the country that are requesting some massive tract of land that they want for free so that they can rent it back to us for some ungodly sum of money. Isn't there some way of settling this whole thing with native people that is both constructive for these people so that they get what they are looking for, and in the same point that the Canadians don't end up paying for it until all eternity? And secondly, giving the Japanese Canadians money is not necessarily going to fix the problem. It was something that was done during war. It was not good.
Okay, we've got your 2 points.
Okay, but you give them money, they're going to spend the next 40 years arguing in courts how to spend the stuff.
Well, the land claims.
With respect to the first item on land claims, in my judgment, the better way to deal with it is through the negotiation of the claim rather than going to the courts. That's been the position of the federal government. Up till now, or up to recently, that has not been the position of the government of British Columbia.
But what he's getting at is the fact that the ordinary working or unemployed Canadian looks at another $300 million, another 70% of Vancouver Island, another massive land claim, and he thinks, is it ever going to end? Or is some judge, on the facts of the case, going to give title to, say, 70% of Vancouver Island and create the most unholy mess?
Well, that's why
That's a danger, isn't it?
That, yes.
Under the Charter of Rights, I mean, it's a danger.
It's hard to know what a judge would do given certain facts in relation to the law.
Right.
I mean, it's really hard to predict that. Not only that, it's a long and expensive process. That is why the position, and I used to argue this case even more strongly when I was Minister of Indian Affairs and Northern Development, we settle and negotiate and settle land claims across the country, in the North and in British Columbia. But the difficulty has been is that there has not been, let me call it, a unity of position between the Government of Canada and the Government of British Columbia to go ahead and negotiate the land claims.
But the man in the streets thinks, my goodness, they are claiming 60% of the land mass of this, that, the next thing. Can't possibly be given to them.
No. And I think that you'll find, it's hard to talk about this in the abstract, but you'll find that there will be kind of the normal process of negotiation. We've negotiated the whole land claim for the East Arctic. For the Nuvialuit and the Mackenzie Delta
Quite
in 1984.
More with David Crombie after the break. And I had Smokey the Bear in the other day from the Vancouver Native, the Canadian Native Council.
Smokey Brewer.
He calls himself Smokey the Bear.
Does he really?
Nice guy. All he wants is the world for a million non-status and Métis.
Yeah.
There's got to be an end. They want a huge tract of British Columbia, the Métis now, too. Treaty 8 or something, or a bit of it.
Okay. I'm Jack. I'm no longer minister of Indian Affairs and Northern Development.
But you are the minister of this.
I don't want to get you into trouble, and I don't want to get me into trouble, so I think I'll stay away from
you. You can't get me into trouble, I don't think. Now, you're going to speak to a young guy from the Pacific Métis Association, and let me explain it. There was the Louis Riel Métis Association, which was wound up, virtually bankrupt, 85,000 in debts, you know, bills not paid.
Yep.
And these people in the Pacific Métis say that they want money from you so they can represent BC Métis at the fourth constitutional conference. Now, I'll put your case for you. What's your question?
Hi, Jack. Mr. Crombie, I'd like to know what your department and you are going to do about the situation in British Columbia with respect to the Métis representation.
I've just explained it. Ask him if he's going to give you any money as a Pacific Métis.
That's one question. I want to know if you're going to give me any money. Give our organization any money, and I want to know if we're going to have representation at the constitutional talks in 1987.
Okay, these are your questions.
Three things. One, questions of who represents whom at the constitutional conference are clearly the responsibility of the Minister of Justice. He carries the ball for the Constitution. I have no comment to make. Secondly, with respect to who represents British Columbia Métis people, I had a meeting in my office with the representatives of British Columbia Métis people, including the representatives from the Métis National Council, the MNA, Métis National Council, it was agreed that during this period, at any rate, they would look after the interests of Métis people in British Columbia until the whole question of financial responsibility and the ability to look after public funds was dealt with properly.
That's because of the Louis Riel Métis.
Absolutely.
Bankruptcy. So therefore, you won't give the Pacific Métis any money on their own right now?
No.
Okay, Sandy. Bye. Go ahead from Okanagan Falls.
Yes. Jack.
Yeah.
I'd like to ask the Honorable Hugh Crombie.
Yes, David.
Close.
David Crombie.
Close.
Mm-hmm. Close.
About this Japanese thing, I understand trade is the big thing, but damn it, we go crawling to the Japanese and pay them because we put the people away during the war. That was an act of war. I was overseas in Hong Kong, and I saw plenty of sabotage going on by the Japanese. Had they landed in Vancouver with a battalion or two, I'll bet you most of those young people would have joined them without any question.
Okay, I don't want I don't want to reopen all the old sores, although I respect your view, and a number of people hold the same views with you. How do you respond to that? What do the vets say to you?
I've met with the representatives of the Canadian Legion, and I might say also with the veterans associations in my own city of Toronto, whom I've known over the years. And they have very strong views about it. Some are different from others. Some reflect the gentleman who just called. Others have an opposite view. Generally speaking, there's a concern registered by the Legion that we are going to diminish the importance of the contribution that people made to the war.
Really is a separate issue altogether.
But it's a separate issue.
I mean, the Americans weren't nearly as rough and tough as we were they?
Well, in Canada, as you know, the property was taken, and I think by all standards, not appropriately dealt with. In the United States, where they were obviously confronted with at least a similar problem with the Second World War, although they removed people from the shorelines, they did not, and put them in camps for a while, they did not take their property. Mm-hmm. But in Canada, we did.
That's a thorny one you still have to settle to the
satisfaction. It's a very difficult
one. Very opposing groups. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. David Crombie.
Yep.
I'd like to wish you a happy new year from an old family that used to live south of you on Alice Avenue.
Give the name.
Howie.
Howie. Howie what?
Oh, my, that's Howie is the last name. Douglas Howie was the boy
good
that used
Lord.
To
I mean, I was,
go to school with you. Do
that's
you
about,
that?
Yes, I do. That was 19, I mean, I left there in 1949 when Jack was learning to ride a bicycle in Scotland.
That's right.
But no, boy, oh boy, that's a long time ago.
Thank you very much. Enough of the social chit-chat. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, hello, Jack. How are you today?
Not bad. I like Crombie. He's a bright guy to talk to. Hey, Mr. Crombie,
that's all right.
His Excellency. Hey,
no, just click your heels.
Yeah, I was just wondering if the federal government has been looking at the recession in the marine industry here in Vancouver and throughout British Columbia, because we have a rather large coastline, and for quite a few years now, a lot of the marine industry guys have been unemployed, the guys who work on tugboats, the guys who work on the docks.
So what's your question?
My question I was wondering if the government has looked at possibly building a small merchant fleet of some sort.
I wish I could help you out, I really do, but it would be inappropriate for me to make any comment whatsoever. I simply don't know the answer. If I did, I would offer you one.
Well, just one thing, when you're in cabinet, make sure, even if it's just straight Paola to the West Coast, that we get the icebreaker and that it doesn't go to Montreal or any other river in the country. That's all we're asking you to do.
I hear you, Jack.
My thanks to David Crombie, Minister of State, Secretary of State, and Minister of Multiculturalism.
Thank you.
And we'll watch your next appointment to the Tories. I'll denounce you.
It'll be a Scotsman.
Well, that's worse. No Scotsman. Now, a serious interview with Archbishop Ted Scott after the break. I'll be quite frank with you. On the issue of South Africa and sanctions, I personally don't really know what to think. Whether or not we should all be in a moral crusade to destroy the white government in South Africa by total sanctions, leading quite obviously to some incredible catastrophe. With me tonight is a man who is one of the Eminent Persons Group, 6 moral leaders of the Commonwealth who went to South Africa. And this is Archbishop Ted Scott, former primate of the Anglican Church of Canada, former moderator of that activist group, the World Council of Churches. And he's going to tell me precisely what he wants to see done. Are you on a moral crusade, first of all, to destroy the Botha government by total sanctions?
No. What we want to see happen is negotiations between that government with the recognized black leaders to move to a new representative government in South Africa so that the white government will not be destroyed. If it keeps on going the way it is now, it will destroy itself.
Yeah, but of course sanctions don't give them any economic base on which they can keep things perhaps a little better than they once were for the very underprivileged black.
The only value of sanctions, they don't solve the problem, is to apply some pressure to try and bring about some fundamental change.
Is it possible to get any fundamental change in the government of Botha? And I'm sure you know what kind of people are in that government. Is that government capable of change, or is it so far to the right that it makes you think of pre-war Germany?
I think the government itself is not that far to the right. We know there are members of that cabinet, we met with 9 of them, who do want change. We're not quite sure where the president stands. He speaks very definitely against any kind of change. But it can't be just a surface change. It's got to be looking at those pillars upon which apartheid is based. When you classify people, black, white, or colored, from the moment of their birth, and that classification determines all their rights and responsibilities, all their hopes for the future, you've got a racially structured injustice. And that needs to be changed.
Has there been no amelioration of the position of the black man? I mean, I had Buthelezi on here the other night, outspoken opponent of apartheid, a man who finds it possible to cooperate with his Zulu people. Some lifting of the pass laws. Mind you, I'm as suspicious as you are about the censorship of the television coverage of what's happening in South Africa. But has there been no amelioration in the past 10 years?
There's been some improvement, but a very slow improvement. And if some of the things that have been done now had been done 10 years ago, they would have been received with real appreciation. But the situation has gone on so long without anything but surface changes that now the black people have very little trust in that government. And one of the major problems is the incredible gulf of communication between the different sections of the country.
Hasn't Botha said that he's prepared to enter negotiations with any South African group that abandons violence, to wit, the African National Council?
He has said that he'd be prepared to enter a negotiation with any group that totally renounces violence. Lord Tony Barber, who had been Chancellor of Exchequer in Heath's government and President of the Conservative government, said he would never ask a group to renounce violence for all time. The British government has never done that. He fought in the RAF during the war. If you're going to deal with issues, you have to face the fact that violence is a reality in human life. What we did call for was the suspension of violence on all sides. The government was not prepared, although initially they agreed to that terminology. Then towards the end of the visit, they backed away from that, and they said they would only negotiate with people who would renounce. Now, if you're involved in the struggle for the whole future of your people, you're not in a position where you can make that kind of commitment with integrity. Mm-hmm. You'd be playing games if you did.
So there's no prospect of any immediate settlement whatsoever in terms of, say, I, Botta, say that we shall have one man, one vote by 1995?
If Botta would come to that situation, but it's not enough to say that. They've made all kinds of promises. They said apartheid is outmoded. But you've got to take some steps to dismantle the Population Registration Act, the Group Area Act, the Homeland Pattern, and the Band of Education. And if you don't dismantle those, you're not dismantling apartheid. You didn't choose to be born white.
No.
You discovered yourself white. Conceivably, you and I both could have discovered yourself black. Mm-hmm. If we'd done that and lived in South Africa, we would have no political rights at all.
So the first thing they do is must release Mandela.
Yes, they need to move towards the releasing of some of the political leaders that are recognized as leaders, and then open the political system for negotiation. Mm-hmm. We didn't go over there with any ready-made solutions to the problem. That's something that's got to be worked out there. Mm-hmm. But it'll only be worked out when black, white, and colored work it out together.
No hope for it, then, is there?
I think there's always hope. Well, look at I'm not optimistic.
Look at Margaret Thatcher. She won't impose total sanctions because of the effect it would have on the economy of British industry. She'd lose a few hundred thousand jobs instantly.
Well, that's true in her judgment in that situation. I think that she overquotes the figures. A lot of the people in England say the same thing. Barclays Bank, as you know, has now moved out, and they haven't done that easily. They've analyzed that situation very carefully. So I think there is a growing pressure in England. As I say, sanctions will not solve the problem, but they are a way of exerting pressure, and they also are a symbolic factor of the West saying to the South African government, we want fundamental change. Mm-hmm. They're also a way of saying to the blacks, we believe you have a right to participate in the decisions that affect your own life politically. And those two things need to be said. Already 60% of Britain's trade with Africa is with black Africa, mm-hmm. only 40% with South Africa. Mm-hmm. Now, in the long run, I think Britain has to give leadership role in relationship to the whole of Africa. Mm-hmm. I don't think that Mrs. Thatcher has any idea of the level of hostility that is growing all across black Africa in terms of the British politics.
What's your scenario now, therefore, if Botta's coming up for an election, isn't he at the end of this month or the end of, when is it?
I think about the middle of 87, he said there'd
March
be election
or April. Yes, yes, March or April. And 3 million white voters.
Yes, I think in that situation, if I can refer to the foreign minister in South Africa, Pik Botta, he indicated that change could take place in three ways. One, by the ballot. And if it takes place by the ballot, it may well be a swing to the right, because only 14.5% of the people vote. Mm-hmm. Or it could be by negotiation with the recognized black leaders, which is the hopeful sign, or it could be by a long, drawn-out, bloody conflict. And we were hoping we could move towards the second and help the government move towards the second.
But your feeling is, and you're not optimistic, is that the result of the election, which Botta will call, will strengthen the rightist influences in his government?
Yes.
Because of fear?
Because of fear, and because of such a small proportion of the people who vote. In this country, if you move towards the left or the right, you pick up people on the other side. Mm-hmm. When you only got 14.5% of the people voting, the people that would give support are not part of the political process.
There is no major white liberal element in Botta's, in the white population of South Africa.
A very weak one. And the problem that's involved there is that the leader of the opposition party resigned the whole political pattern because it was going to be a farce.
If supposing the whites were wiped out tomorrow, God forbid, would that not create great tactical difficulties for the West, with South Africa going into untrained and untutored hands?
Yes,
and perhaps the invasion by those from Angola, or who God knows where.
I think the issue would, but I think that's not a feasible possibility. From what we met of the responsible black leaders, and there are many of them, mm-hmm. there's no desire to wipe out the whites. If you look at the situation in Kenya, there are more whites in Kenya now than there were before while it was a colony. If you look at Zimbabwe, there's a growing number of whites returning to Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. And there is an alternative. And the black leaders we spoke to want and appreciate the contribution of the whites and want a representative government that is multiracial.
Are you still welcome in South Africa, I suppose you are?
I'm keeping in contact with people there. I'm not directly involved. The group of seven that was appointed has ceased to exist as of July of last year.
Mm-hmm. Archbishop Ted Scott, one of the Eminent Persons Group. That was a good name. Who chose that?
Not me. When you have four Canadian children and six Canadian grandchildren, that kind of title doesn't go down very well.
Oh, hello, Eminent Person,
yeah.
Grandpa.
Yeah, exactly.
Your questions to Archbishop Scott after the break. Archbishop Scott, we're talking about South Africa, and here's the first call. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Hello. Hello, Bishop Scott.
Yes.
And Mr. Webster, good evening.
Right. Evening.
Bishop Scott, I was born in Johannesburg 43 years ago.
And what's your point?
What I would like to ask you, sir, is what are your perceptions of Chief Buthelezi's statements last week, or just before Christmas on Mr. Webster's show, in which he pointed out that he would have to resort to violence perhaps within 2 years?
Yeah, the violence would break out perhaps within 2 years.
The reality is that violence is already there. The whole system is violent in its operation. Blacks are dying at a rate of 3 to 5 a day in South Africa and have been for some months. So the violence is in the situation. Our hope is that there could be negotiation so that you would reduce the increase, the escalation of the violence. If the government does not act very soon, I think the violence will increase.
There are the proponents of the South African side, the government side, who say that most of the violence is between blacks.
I think that is not true. There is a certain amount of violence between blacks, and that in part is encouraged by the government. Because what you have happening is people become allied with the government and sell out to the government. If you go to some of the independent homelands, you'll see black leaders whose salary comes from the government living in absolute luxury alongside people in great poverty.
Does Buthelezi fall into that category?
No, he doesn't.
He doesn't.
He fights the edge of that situation, but I think he comes very close to allowing himself to be used by the government at times. Let me use an illustration. When he spoke in the Eastern Canada, he talked about the importance of a multi-party system, and I support a multi-party system, although I believe in the loyal opposition, not in automatic party politics. But there's no part of South Africa that is more rigidly one party than KwaZulu. Mm-hmm. If you don't belong to Mkata, you don't get anywhere in KwaZulu. So to say one thing outside and then to operate another one internally raises questions for me.
Go ahead, please.
Bishop Scott.
Yes.
Yes, I'd like to ask you two questions, and then I'll hang up. Was your church and yourself, were you involved in giving, I think it was $225,000 or $250,000 to rebels about 3 or 4 years ago, to some of the African rebel fronts? And plus, does your church, or you yourself, do you belong to the World Council of Churches?
Yes.
I'll hang up and listen to your reply.
Thank you.
Yes, we were involved in our church in Canada in giving grants to the program to combat racism. Grants are made out of that program to liberation groups in Africa for humanitarian purposes. They were monitored pretty carefully, and there's no evidence that money was ever used for anything but humanitarian purposes. And we do not apologize for those grants.
Okay, the next one, World Council of Churches. You were, of course, the moderator of the World Council of Churches at one time.
I was from 1975 to 1983.
But after the allegations that some of your money was going to guerrilla purposes, donations dried up to the WCC.
No, they didn't. As a matter of fact, the donations to the special fund increased after that allegation. Now, there was tension in churches in terms of that kind of operation, and that tension, I think, is understandable. But the actual giving to that particular fund, because it wasn't out of the general funds, it was money specially given for that purpose, increased after the allegations.
Refugees, medical supplies, housing, and education.
That's right.
Fair enough. Go ahead, please.
Good evening, Bishop Scott.
Good evening.
I was wondering how you could, in good conscience, support a duly convicted murderer and a lady who has advocated publicly the use of the necklace as a legitimate means of bringing about change.
I don't support either one of those on that basis. Nelson Mandela was not committed or condemned for murder. He was charged with sabotage, which he didn't deny. He was actually acquitted of treason, and the Superior Court in South Africa has acquitted many people in that situation because they claim the Freedom Charter was not a treasonable document. So he was condemned for sabotage. And the African National Congress moved at a particular point after about 50 years of nonviolent work totally to tactical violence. And they did it for two reasons. One, because it reminded the government that they existed, they were there. The second thing, and it's a tragic thing, is it was very difficult to get much coverage in the Western press unless there were events around which stories could be written. And that's a tragic thing about the situation. And that's two of the reasons why they moved in that direction. I don't condone necklace in any way, shape, or form. I have told Winnie Mandela that I was sorry that she made a statement like that, and I think she regrets it herself.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
Yes. I believe that the black people in South Africa shouldn't go for a settlement. I think that they have to fight until they take over that country. The white people still own all the means of production, and the white people will constantly keep the black people down, even if racism isn't an issue anymore. Okay.
Thank you.
The issue is whether or not you can go for a pattern of government that allows the changing of some of the patterns. You're quite right in saying that under the Group Areas Act, but 86% of the land is reserved for the 14.5% of the whites, and that has to be changed. But I conceive of a government that's able to change those kind of things as we make changes in Canada. There is a strong feeling, and you've set it forth here, that what has to happen in South Africa is not a sharing of power, but a transfer of power. I would still hope that there could be some responsible sharing of power rather than a complete transfer.
Mm-hmm. We'd have to take all the white refugees from South Africa, wouldn't we?
Well, they'd have to be cared for somewhere, although many of them, I think, are South Africans and would not want to leave, and the majority of the black leaders we met there don't want them to leave. They know so much of the white people.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Bishop Scott. I'd like to ask you whether or not you feel optimistic about the possibility of Nelson Mandela being released by the white government.
No, I don't. The white government says they would like to release Nelson Mandela, and I think that they, in one sense, would, because if he dies in prison, then they've got a real martyr situation. The problem is that they have tried to build an image of Nelson Mandela, and it's very common here in the West, as a Marxist terrorist, which I do not believe he is, having met with him twice and having read a great deal about his background. He's a person of very deep commitments on a national level. And if he was released and appeared on television for two programs, I think he would destroy the whole image the South African government has tried to create of him. And I think that's a problem they face in releasing him. He will not accept a humanitarian release. He will not accept a release that enforces him to go outside the country. He said he was arrested for political activity. If he's going to be released, it will be to take part again in political activity.
You saw him in prison?
Yes.
They let you go and see him?
Yes. Mm-hmm. This is why we felt we were making some progress, because we saw more groups of people right across the country than any other group that's ever visited South Africa, and we were hopeful for a period, and then things collapsed.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, please.
Hi, Fat Jack. As much as we all don't...
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yeah.
I'd like to ask about the children that have been detained and tortured, if Mr. Scott has any information about it, and how many there are.
Okay.
I think it's very difficult for anyone to give a clear picture on that situation. The estimates were that after the crackdown in June, there were about 23,000 people in detention. And the estimates are that about 60% of those are under 16. Mm-hmm. We saw children in jail. I visited some of them and saw them in the situation there that were in detention. And we saw Shambok marks and we saw wounds and bruises on those people.
There I must chop you off. My grateful thanks to your excellent exposition of the situation in South Africa from the point of view of Archbishop Ted Scott, prominent Canadian, eminent person in his own right.
Thank you, sir.
I'll be back after the break. Well, before I forget, the good Archbishop is speaking tonight at Christchurch Cathedral at 8 p.m. And I had him on the air today because of help from the UBC Centre for Continuing Education. Promised him a plug. What are you doing here, Wyatt? Hey, Wyatt, what are you? You haven't done a tap of work all week, and now here you are sitting all tizzy up. What's going on?
I'm leaving you, Jack.
I won't allow it.
I'm leaving the fold and...
Steve is going to a job as associate producer of Canada AM in Toronto, and we're all here terribly sorry to see him go. He's been with me how long? How many years have you been with me?
This is my seventh year we've been together. It's been a long time. That's right.
Is it a call for Steve there? Where is it? Is it a setup call?
Uh-oh. Who is this?
I'm afraid of this. Go ahead, please.
No, I just wanted to talk to Steve personally because he was going to set up an appointment.
Hold
Sorry.
Steve, then what would your new job consist of, really?
I'll be associate producer of Canada AM, and basically I'll be producing the show in the morning and putting it on the air, so I'll be starting at 5 a.m.
Well, if you want me on, you be very careful.
That's right.
Steve, all the very best
Thank
of
you
luck
very much,
from
Jack.
All of us. I know you'll be
Thank
a
you.
Riot to success.
Thank you very much, Jack.
Monday, 5 p.m.
Wyatt,
precisely.
Wyatt, 457 stories, Steve, since you've been here. This makes 458. All the editors really loved working with you. Good luck in Toronto.
Jack, we're down here at the Orpheum Theater where a lot of big names have been arriving lately. And when those personalities come to town, it's up to us to make sure everybody else gets to meet them. And there's a very special person in town this week. And here he is, Big Bird.
Oh, hi there.
Hello, Big Bird.
How are you?
Not bad.
Who are you?
I'm not sure at this very moment, or where I am. Listen, I'm supposed to be in training here to become a kind of investigative reporter. What kind of dirt can you tell me about Sesame Street?
Well, let's see.
Personally, I thought you were awful.
Well, you know, you taught me everything I know, Jack. What can I say?
Well, that woman's right. I am a pompous ass in these things. I mean, she is right.
What was your first clue?
Keep smiling, keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for.
I'll miss you, Steve, but as long as I can call you at Canada AM, it'll be okay.
It's been short but sweet, Steve. I'll miss you. Can I have your desk?
Hi, Stevie. All the success in the world. I'll miss you.
For good times.
Oh, bigger spoonful than that. Come on.
I'm too much of a coward.
No Scottish blood in you, I can see.
That's...
You better not. Jack, I'm standing on top of a no man's land. For the last 50 years, this territory has been out of bounds to the public. But that is about to change. By 1986, 23,000 acres at this height may open up to the public. The GVID wants to open it up because the water district is changing.
Speak today. Wait, hold on. Get this swine off your lip.
My nose is just running all over the place.
But they haven't forgotten the past. The past. Hi, I'm Steve Wyatt. And you're not.
As the water began to recede, some of the roads became visible again, but still a portage is required to get to some of these other homes.
Look at that. Just unreal.
God, this heat,
I think it's time to move out. Let's go.
Great, Steve. Take care. I'll miss you. Bye.
You're the best guy to work for, Eddie. For you, I would fly.
Steve. It is Steve, isn't it? I was right off the bat. I should have kept on going.
But who's going to correct our English? Goodbye, Steve.
That's what friends are for.
That's what friends are for.
Yeah. Hi, Steve. I've known you the longest, and I know that I'll miss you the most. The very, very best of everything to you. Bye.
With all the precision at my command, let me say, Steve, I know you will have nothing but success in the East, and I'm sad as you leave me at 6 p.m. precisely.